dotnet aspire. Every single dotnet developer on YouTube is talking about this, apart from me. I've waited up till now. I did a quick little survey and it said that you actually wanted to hear my probably spicy thoughts on this, so sorry to keep you waiting. If you've been living under a rock and you're not quite sure what dotnet aspire is, check the Microsoft docs here. They originally started building dotnet aspire probably halfway through 2023, announced the original 0.1 release in November 2023 with this blog post. They then released 8 preview versions and managed to make it all the way through to general availability, which the chief Chad developer himself, Damien Edwards, announced on May 2024. Now, this is fast. This is less than a year of development to get here. And they added it to .NET 8, even while working on .NET 9. And this could have been a .NET 9 exclusive to get you all to upgrade. But no, it was important enough to make work with .NET 8. And when you actually read it, this isn't about what you think it is. The key quote is, ".NET Aspire is an opinionated stack for building resilient, observable, and configurable cloud-native applications with .NET." Notice that they've actually emphasized opinionated, not cloud. Why is this important? Well, first we're going to have a take a quick look at .NET Aspire itself, and then we'll have a history lesson. If we create a new .NET Aspire template, we get some projects. We get an API project, app host, and so on. If we actually run app host, however, we get a dashboard. This is an actual .NET dashboard built by the .NET team, and that is so important. We get free stuff. So we get a console, so we can see all the app services, and we get the logs come through. We've got structured logging, which is like open telemetry stuff. We get traces, so if you actually make web requests, you can see how long each request took, and traces within those requests, and metrics, so we can even monitor some of these services and see some nice charts about the performance of your .NET app. That's what you get out of the box. So why is this special? Well, this puts a massive stake in the ground from the .NET team of what they think best practice is. And you can hear the whimpers of lots of homemade little cottage frameworks across companies everywhere, just dying slowly as .NET Aspire is going to finally standardize all of those. But why is standardization important? Well, let's go back in time. So back in the days of 2004, when I had hair and was far better looking, Ruby on Rails came out. Ruby on Rails was an MVC web framework powered by the Ruby language. And this introduced and made massively popular the MVC pattern. And you can blame this guy for all of this. The difference between Rails MVC and almost anything else at the time was the philosophy of convention over configuration. Now, let's read it. You're not a beautiful and unique snowflake. That's right. Your project does not need to be special. It just needs to be a normal project. And this went through the mentality of the whole way Rails was designed. If you wanted to edit a controller, you knew where the controllers were. And if you wanted to edit a view, you knew where the views were going to be and what the file name was going to be. And it was all nice and standard across projects. So at the time, Microsoft only had web forms. Web forms was not a very nice piece of technology and tried to hide and abstract the way the internet worked. Over time, they realized that Rails was getting increasing in popularity. So their response was ASP.NET MVC. 1.0 came out in 2009, and it was great, absolutely brilliant. It copied the convention over configuration philosophy from Rails, and if you needed to edit a controller, you knew where to find it. I loved it. We all loved it. And it was so popular that it went on for 5 versions, essentially stayed popular all the way through to when .NET Core was being invented at the end of the 2010s. It was great. For a period of time, we had an opinionated framework in .NET. Controllers were where you thought they were going to be. And unless the architect was trying to get super clever, we knew what to expect on any new project. Eventually, MVC here was merged in with the web API controllers, which were a separate branch. And when .NET Core came out, they all merged into the concept of a single type of MVC controller, and this was no longer a separate thing. But for some people, that was too difficult. Some people can't do architecture, and some people can't do convention over configuration. because you actually have to learn something. You have to learn what the convention is. And this is, acts as a little bit of a roadblock, sadly. Microsoft were also missing web forms. Web forms was click and drag, drag and drop, double click, button one, on click event, nightmare. But a lot of people needed that to actually be able to build software at all. So Microsoft took the Vue engine from MVC and made Razor Pages. Razor Pages was going to be the next web forms, nice and easy. it even had code behind. You know, remember code behind? .cs with the same file name? The problem here is that Razor Pages eventually was injected with some sort of compound and ended up as Blazor. And Blazor again, because Blazor embraced putting your code wherever you liked. You could put it in the page, you could put it in the code behind, you could put it somewhere else. You really could make your application unique as you, in fact. Pretty painful. Then they did minimal APIs, right? Minimal APIs, even better. We will not say how you're going to get your data out of your database onto your screen. We're just going to give you some endpoints and leave it up to you. You could call the database directly in your GET handler. You could use fast endpoints. You could create your own controllers. Who cares? Off you go. And at this point, there is no answer to building a web application in .NET. It could be Blazor. It could be Razor Pages. Could be MVC. Who knows? Who cares? It was a really sad time. But why is this important? Well, they abandoned any sort of direction other than trying to give people as many options as possible. And now they have .NET Aspire. Now, because everything was so free during those days, we did get some pretty cool tools. I don't know if anybody remembers Elmer. Elmer was pretty cool. But now you don't need Elmer anymore because it's built into .NET Aspire. Don't suppose you remember Mini Profiler, which was actually ported from Ruby because it started off in the Ruby on Rails days to .NET by the Stack Exchange geniuses. You don't need this anymore either because tracing is also built into .NET Aspire. Previously, all of these tools were expected to be built by the .NET community essentially for free. But we are paying Microsoft for the use of Visual Studio and the C# toolkit and our Azure bills, so it's nice to have something meaningful. What I'd like to see are more tabs on the left here. So not just monitoring and cloudy stuff, but what about a database browser or an admin panel? User management, how about an API browser? They're doing something with Swagger and I think they're removing it and I hope they don't. But why can't I browse the API endpoints here instead of just getting a JSON blob? That'd be nice, wouldn't it? Why not visitor analytics? You know, if this, it could be like a built-in little Google Analytics thing. I'm sure a healthy ecosystem of plugins will be developed for Aspire. I might even build one myself. I'm thinking of taking this and making this a Aspire component, which I think would be quite useful. So if you think that's going to be useful, let me know in the comments. So I'm actually excited about .NET Aspire. Thank you, team, for building it. Let's bring some order to the chaos the previous 10 years. And get some convention over configuration and an opinionated framework back to .NET, as it should be, as all frameworks should be. Thanks for watching.